90.3 FM. It's a beautiful Thursday morning on your radio, 98.3 FM. And the 8th day of the month of July 2021. We're in the 7th month, the year of our Lord. A very good morning greetings to each and every single soul doing the lesson right here, right now, wherever you are, hearing my voice. Time for us to serve you another edition of the Windy Morning Express. That's a breakfast. And on the Windy Morning Express, always we'll begin with radio lecture. This morning is for all level handed students. Study the course EDCR 121, Introduction to Educational Technology. This morning we're looking at the topic, types and characteristics of instructional media. Types and characteristics of instructional media. Lecturers Bernard Amwakon and Samuel Foridankwa from the Department of Educational Foundations, University of Education. But don't forget, still lines will be activated for you to be part of the lecture this morning. Write down the number ahead of time. 0503923158 and 0332320201. WhatsApp and text is 0503923158. Don't forget, we're streaming live on Facebook. Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. You can also listen to us live on the university homepage. That's www.uew.ed.gh. So without much ado, let me go and welcome the gentleman as brings us this morning's editions of Radio Lecture. That's for level 100 students in the course EDCR 121, Introduction to Educational Technology. And good morning to you, Bernard and Damkwa. Grateful having you this morning. I hope you're doing well.
Yeah, we're very grateful.
Right, I guess the students are ready for this morning's radio lecture.
Thank you very much. Good morning, students. Good morning, everyone hearing us for today. We come to your various hostels, we come to your various rooms, and we present to you the lecture that we normally have in class. This, we are bringing the lecture to your doorstep, and we will still remind our students that COVID is around, and make sure that you wear your mask, you sanitize, and keep distance. Today we are going to take a look at the concept, types of media, and classification or characteristics of instructional media. That is what we are going to do today. But before that, we will need to just do some recap of what we learned earlier on in class. So for some weeks now, we have been talking about media. And if you remember, we said media comes from the Latin word medium, and it means between. And we went on to say that it can only be called instructional media when it is used for instructional purposes. We further understood that educational media should be a means to an end, but not an end in itself. Then again, we say that educational media should be a good servant, but not a bad master. Or we said educational media should not be a master to the teacher, but rather a good servant. So today, we are going to look at types of instructional media. Types of instructional media. Then again, we will look at the characteristics and the classification of these instructional media. So if you are ready with your handout or with your books and pens, let's begin.
And to help me with the discussion, I have my brother Samuel Ofori-Dankwa to help me. Samuel, you are welcome.
Thank you very much, Scully.
Yes. So we are going to look at instructional media and its types. And if you remember, we earlier talked of what the media is, talk of the various media and how it can be grouped. But today we want to go into details and look at types of instructional media. So with the types of instructional media, there are a lot of media that are used in the classroom, and its purpose is for instruction. As we discussed, if it is used elsewhere, then you can classify it as differently. But here we are talking of the media that is used in the classroom for the purposes of instruction. And don't be confused when we're talking of media. Most of the times, what we refer to are the TLMs. So the TLM that we use in the classroom are what we are referring to as instructional media, because they are used for the purposes of instruction. So we have different types of media. And today you understand that, oh, okay, so this that I was using in class can be classified as a media. So first of all, we talk of real objects and models. Real objects and models. In most of the cases, when we are to accompany our lesson with a TLM or with a media, if we don't get the original, we look for alternative, or what we normally call the improvisation. So we have the real object and we have its models. So example is that maybe we are going to teach types of fruit. You are going to teach types of fruit. And with this type of fruit, you want to go to classroom with different kinds of fruit. So you may have banana, you may have oranges, you may have fruit.
Okay, tangerine.
So you can have tangerine.
Yes.
Yes. So all these are real objects in its original form or in its natural form. That's at a point in time in the lesson, you want to show it to the student that when you talk of orange, this is how orange looks like. These are the characteristics of orange. It grows in this season. If you take banana, you can talk of it. This is banana. You show it to them. Let the student feel it. But in the absence of this real object or this original or the real ones or its natural form, now when you go to the market, we have eight different types also available. Now with technology, most of them are in a plastic form. So you can buy the plastic orange, you can buy the plastic banana, you can buy the plastic apple and show it to the students. So it's either you have the real object in its natural form, in its original form, to add to your lesson, or you can talk of the models. That's a representation or a replica of the real object or the original. Again, you are a science student. You want to teach the digestive system of a mammal. It's either you go for the real object, it's either you go for a rabbit and you bisect and use it to demonstrate the lesson. Or now we have eight models. So we have the plastic ones that are modeled as a human being. So you can pick the various parts of the digestive system of the mama to show that, okay, this is what we call the stomach. This is what we call the pancreas. This is what we call the colon. This is what we call the anus, the rectum, the appendix. All of them, you can show it to the student to make the teaching and the learning more interesting and more easier for the student to comprehend. So that's the difference between real objects and models. The second type of instructional media that we want to talk about is the printed text. Printed text. When we are talking of printed text, then we are talking of all the materials, the written materials that we use to help students understand whatever concept that we are teaching. So it can either be your books, it can either be your handout, it can either be your worksheet. So those of us who are in early childhood or basic education, especially early childhood, who teaches the children how to write, they have their worksheet, my first copy book, where they learn how to do the writing. So they will see the letter over there and they try to model the letter. They try to write the letters that they see. So we have these printed texts that can also serve as what? Instructional media. Instructional media. The third type that we want to talk about is the printed visuals. We have the second one that we talked about was printed text. Then we have printed visuals. Printed visuals. So these printed visuals, we are talking about images that we use to drum home our lesson, to help the student to have a pictorial view of whatever is being taught. So you can have pictures, you can have drawings, you can have charts, you can have graphics. Now, there's nothing that you want to teach that you cannot get a picture version to show your student. Now, the internet has given us a lot of resources. So what do you want to teach? What is the central idea in what you are going to teach? So if you know the central idea, just go onto Google, type in, okay, fruit. You type in fruit, then you go click on images. It will give you a lot of pictures of different types of fruits. And when you are printing these pictures, you have to also take into consideration the context or the location of where you are teaching. The internet doesn't know that you are in Winneba and there are some fruits that you cannot access them in Winneba and the student cannot relate with it in Winneba. So you, whatever that you are printing out, you also have to take into consideration the locality that you find yourself. So you can print this, and whilst you are teaching, you show them. Or even to help decorate your classroom, to make your classroom environment more enticing, you can paste some of these images. Are you talking about the political heads in Ghana from maybe 2000 to the current? You can have the images of President Kufuor. You can have the images of President the late President Mills. You can have the images of the former President Mahama. You can also have the images of Akufo-Addo, all pasted on the walls to help the student to understand, okay, these are the political heads from 2000 to the current, or 2001. So you can have them. So this is what we call printed visuals. This is what we call printed visuals. So we have printed texts and we have printed visuals. The fourth one that we want to talk about is the display boards. Display boards means anything that helps the student to see whatever you are talking about. So when we're talking of traditional media, we were using the chalkboard. So we write on the chalkboard. And I quite remember, even those of us who went to the training college, we were taught even how to use the chalkboard. So whatever notes that you want to give to the student, you write it on the chalkboard, and the student will see, read it, and also copy. If it is exercise, you write it on the chalkboard for everybody to see it. Apart from the chalkboard, we have the bulletin. And in addition to the bulletin, we have the multi-purpose. So the multi-purpose is an electronic device that helps in teaching and learning. And most of the time, you see some of these things in the science department or in the department that runs science programs, or some of the social sciences also have it. So we have this device which has incorporated in it some tools. So if you want to prepare any experiment, you just have to pick the tools. The tools are on the device. You just have to pick the tools and position them. And if you remember, during the last election, a lot of the media houses were using this multi-purpose board, electronic boards. Some call it magic wall, some call it, they have different names depending on how it is being used. So you can use this to help the student understand the concept that you are teaching. So when you are talking of display boards, you are talking of chalkboard, you are talking of bulletin, you are talking of multi-purpose. Another type of media that we want to talk about is slice and film strips. Slice and film strips.
Okay, so we'll get to slides and film strips. We are looking at slides in terms of words that are, or words and images that find themselves on substrates. Here, substrates, I mean paper or anything that can be printed on. So we have an opportunity to have flip sheets that can display both text and images. When you also come to its digital format, we have applications on our computers where we put on them or represent on them same intent. So you can design, as my colleague had earlier indicated, objects, images, texts, and in other words, in their bullet forms, so that you can display the content of these items to your learner. So in actual sense, slides are also very good when it comes to instructional media. We also have the film strips. These are compilations of either images or visuals that come with sound that are compiled on either film or, in today's world, digital versions of that can be videos, which are also shown to students or learners for them to appreciate the content and objective of their learning processes. We also come in here with audio. Audio is the voice or the ability to hear or listen in into what the teacher intends the learner to listen to or hear. So in the process, there are devices that we use in getting this done. We have the tape, which can host audio. We have the disc, and then we have our natural voice as well. Then video and film. There's a slight difference between the film strips, which are in explaining terms, pictures that are compiled into various sessions that are displayed or run for the visual appreciation of what you would want to communicate to your students or the learner. So for example, slides can also even be put as film strips so that you display it as though it was a video. But when you come to video and film in itself, video, we record the processes and then we show them to the learner. Film has similar characteristics as video, but films are a broader compilation of concepts that are put together in a wider time duration for students or learner or viewership. Then we come to television. Television is broadcasted live, though content may be filed, or we say recorded or previous recordings, but usually is transmitted live for viewership. And so for instructional purposes, recently when we were in COVID at its peak, we realized that most televisions also became useful where teaching and lesson was effectively conducted. Learners took opportunity, so as instructors or facilitators, and we all could appreciate the beauty in television as an instructional media. Here in UAW, we have used television as one key opportunity. If I say television, most of us saw some of the content that you were to be delivered to, transmitted to you live. Even with this current presentation, you can watch it live as a stream on Facebook. You can go to YouTube, you can go to Instagram, Twitter, and other platforms to have a visual transmission of what is happening right now in the studios of Radio Windy Bay. Then we have the computer software. Software are the compilation of components that seeks to draw or make it possible for concepts to be arrived at. So they are designed specifically for purposes, and usually you find them on your computer. I will leave the rest for my colleague to continue.
All right, so taking it from there, now there are a lot of software that are used in presentation or that are used in teaching and learning. Most of the times you go to some of these our early grade schools, and because there their attention span is less than 5 to 7 minutes, all their lessons are activity based, and with that they have a lot of softwares of courses and activities that the student can even partake in. Even in the university, we have also a lot of softwares. You can, the common ones that we can talk of is the Microsoft Suite, which helps us to do our assignment, which helps us to do our presentations, which helps us to do our calculations. You can even talk of SPSS, of which most of the project work you see that statement there. My data was analyzed using SPSS software. All these are used for instructional purposes. If you go to geography, they have their software that they use. If you go to history, they have their software that they use. Most all of the department have different software that aid them in their teaching and in their learning. As my brother said, during the COVID, we saw most of the lecturers doing lecture on Telegram, doing lectures on WhatsApp, doing lectures on VClass, doing lectures on Google Classroom. There are a lot of softwares that students can explore. Even at this time of COVID that we are talking of distance, social distance, and you don't necessarily need to go to the hostel or to go to the room of your colleague. Now, most part of the university, we have the Wi-Fi connection. So you can even stay in your hostel and still communicate with your friends or your study group mates. You share ideas, and this will bring you up to date on how to use technology to improve teaching and learning. So that's what we are talking about, that we have instructional medias and we have various types of it. What are you going to teach? How are you going to teach it? What you are going to teach and how you are going to teach it will inform the type of instructional media that you should accompany your lesson with, that you should accompany your lesson with. So that's what we are saying. So we've talked of rare objects. If you have just joined us, we have talked of rare objects and models. We've talked of printed tests. We've talked of printed visuals. We've talked of display boards. We talk of slides and film strips. We've talked of audio. We've talked of video. We've talked of television. And we've talked of computer software. The last that we want to talk about is the web. And I've talked about it earlier that now the internet has given us unlimited educational resources. What are you going to teach? Go to YouTube. Just type it in there. You get a video instruction of what people have done about that concept. How did they teach it? What lesson can you draw from it? How will you be able to model the lesson that you're going to teach on what you have read, seen, and heard? So today, we don't have any excuses when it comes to incorporating technology in our lesson to make teaching and learning to be more efficient and to be more effective. So today we are to look at the types of instructional media and the characteristics of instructional media. So if you have just joined us, you can still start to send in your questions or your contributions on 0503923158 on WhatsApp or text 0503923158, or you can put your questions or your comment on our Facebook wall and it will be read and answered. So we are going to look at the characteristics of media, or the characteristics of instructional media. If you look at the types, what are these characteristics? The first one we want to talk about is that they have the capability to diffuse information and knowledge. They have the capability to diffuse information and knowledge. When you say something has the capability to diffuse information and knowledge, then we are saying that it has the ability to send information from one point to another. So now we are here in the studio having this lecture, but somebody is in Ejumako who can hear us talk and can see us. Somebody is in Jinjinaze, or somebody is in local, somebody is at Charles Beach. We are spread all over. Even some are in Kaswa still are benefiting from this lecture. So that's why we are saying that characteristics of instructional media, one is that they have the capability to diffuse, to broadcast, to send the information. You have a saying in Akan that If you want to say something to God, you say it to the wind. And we know that God is everywhere. So when you say it to the wind will carry it. It's based on this concept that we are saying that instructional media has the capability or has the potentials of diffusing information to a lot of people. Now, when we use microphones and we use speakers in our lecture rooms, it's to help for the person sitting at the back to be able to hear whatever is being said. Without a microphone or without a speaker, it's only those who are in front who will benefit, leaving those at the back. But for everybody to benefit from the lecture, we say that you have to use speakers, and with the help of the microphone, everybody can hear whatever you are teaching. Another characteristic of instructional media that we want to talk about, we are saying that they have the capability to show color, motion, symbolic representation or simulation, pictures, and sound. Dankwa, how do you understand this?
Thank you very much. The capacity to show color, motion, or symbolic representation is very simple. Media in its variety or content has the ability to show pictures. Just not pictures, but pictures that run, that which we call motion. So if you went right now on social media and you were on Facebook, for example, you see us talking, you see the gesturing, I am moving my hand, you see my hand move. Same way, media has a characteristic where if you were listening to me on radio, you would not see my hands. You would not see me nod my head or move my head from left to right as I illustrate what I am saying. But then you would hear in clear language what I am saying and will still make deductions or inferences to make an understanding. Same way, when we come to the capacity to show color, motion, and symbolic representations, you can demonstrate by using slides and other material, same, which will help learners also appreciate motion, pictures, and sound. You can also have a situation where it is only pictures that will be demonstrated or shown to the learner. And at that stage, we'll say it is static, and my colleague would take it from there.
Yes. So in addition to what my brother Dankwa said about the capability to show color, if you remember when we were talking about media, we came to a point, we talked of multimedia. Multimedia, using more than one medium to demonstrate a concept. So whatever slides that we show, you see at least there are some colors in it, there are some pictures in it. All these are put together to show and demonstrate the concept that we want to teach. That's one of the characteristics of instructional media. The next characteristics of instructional media that we want to talk about is that some are static. And when you say some are static, they do not move. As it was, it is. So when you talk of pictures, pictures doesn't move. If you take a picture, the position that you stood to take the picture, when you watch it 1,000 times, it will be the same. So if you are taking a picture as an instructional aid or as a media to the classroom, how the picture looks like, if you hang it, is not going to change. If it's about the political heads of Ghana, you have their pictures there. The picture, the color that the picture was taken is not going to change. Or if you talk of photographs, you talk of maps, and we are seeing that apart from some being static, others are dynamic, meaning they changes So if you are watching the television, you see that from one scene to the other, or from one story to another, it keeps on changing. There are movement. As Dankwa said, you see people moving from one point to another, showing some gestures. They are not static. I quite remember those days, we had one of the socialization play we call STEAM. Mm. So when you see your friend, the first person who is to shout STEAM means that you have to stand static. You don't have to move until somebody comes to touch you.
Yeah.
Then you are offloaded of your magnetism, or you're offloaded of your steam. Steam was the local word for magnet. So yeah. If you say steam, and you say when magnet touches metal, it sticks to it. So when we tell you that steam, you just stand there until somebody comes to touch you, then you move. So that's what we say, it is static. But apart from that, we have some of the pictures, or we have some medias that are dynamic, that shows movement, that shows gestures. So if you take a selfie of yourself, or if you take now they call it Snapchat, so you then TikTok, you take a TikTok and you see people moving. So you can also use media that shows, that have some dynamics, especially with the early grade student, you use rhymes and you use riddles and some poems, and they will see images moving up and down for them to also emulate and imitate that image. As they imitate, they also learn. As they imitate, they also do learn. Then we are seeing that some of the media, their characteristic is that they are locally designed. Others are also commercially produced. So as a teacher, whilst you are going to class, knowing what you are going to teach and how you are going to teach it, you have to find out the TLM that you are, that will accompany you, are you going to do it yourself, or you are going to buy them? And always I caution students that when you're going to buy them, know what is on it.
Mm-hmm.
Know what is on it, and know if it is a CD, you the teacher, you have to watch it and know which part of the video you want to talk about. If you have downloaded any video on YouTube, make sure that you watch it and understand and see the correlation between the video and what you are going to teach. And then again, we are seeing that some of the media are big and complex. We're talking of televisions, we're talking of computers. Some are big and complex, whilst others are small and less expensive. So if you have to draw an apple on a chart or on a Manila card, it's less expensive and it's less easier to do it. Or even you can even print it. You don't necessarily have to draw it yourself. You go to images and you print it. So you can join us with your questions and with your comment and with your contribution on 0503-923-158, 0503-923-158, or 0332-320201. So your questions are welcome, and we will be ready to help you understand what your challenge is. So the lines are open, but whilst we wait, we also want to talk about the classification of instructional media. We will end it there whilst we wait for your question.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Amako. As we wait for your questions, we are taking the opportunity to take ourselves through classification of instructional media. In this life, generally, before you would want to even talk to anyone, your father, your mother, your sister, your wife, your husband, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, whichever way, or even when you went to church and you wanted to pray, everyone looks at which best way to get it done. If you want to talk to someone, if you want to send an information to someone. And so for this particular discussion, we are looking at the teacher and the pupil or student. So one of the key elements for every teacher or principle for every teacher is that you need to know your learner, know your learner or your student. Once you have done that, this helps you at all times when you want to introduce any thing into the learning process, any new device, any new software, any new approach. So today we are looking at instructional media. How do I, as a teacher, send information, being it pictorial, visual, or audiovisual, to my learner so my learners will appreciate the same way I set my objective for the lessons? So one, we saying that there is print, the print media. Early on, Mr. Marcus indicated that there is a component where we have only text that is printed on paper so that the learner can read and understand. So that constitutes part of print. Generally, you have the newspapers, which are also out there, which we are commonly associated with, and our textbooks, which we are also generally associated with. The non-print media is also there. This one, we have that which is projected. This one, we have it as what? Projected. Or it is beamed on a substrate or a surface where you can see it, but it is not printed on any document or any paper or substrate where you can hold it and attest to that this is print. We have electronic media as well. If you pick your phone up right now, you see characters, you see a lot of information displayed on the interface. Same on your laptop and even on your television. So we classify that as electronic media, that which is demonstrated or displayed on digital surfaces, which come to us via LED screens, plasma. Today we don't have plasma, a lot of plasma not available, but we have LEDs that are on the market today. And so you have high definition, low resolution, mid resolution definitions based on what device you hold. So that is print, non-print, and electronic media. Then we come to projected media and non-projected media under classification of instructional media. So here, as Mr. Marco had early on also indicated, we have media that must be projected, but then for the projection to happen, it needs light, the beaming of light through a device or a component that helps demonstrate or display the content of what you want learner to appreciate on a surface. So the projection is also one of the classification of instructional media. And we have non-projected media. Non-projected media can also find itself in print media. That is any media that is printed but is not projected. Media that is printed but it's not projected. So an example is, if I have a textbook and it is bound and binded, it becomes a non-projected media. So the student or the pupil in my lecture or my class has a book called a test book. Remember, it is test book, a book containing test material, where you look at it and you can read and understand, but it is not projected on the wall. Meanwhile, the slides that have contents or components or excerpts of the textbook or what I intend to teach is projected through a medium on the wall by the help of lights, so you can see that one on another surface. Classification of instructional media. The next one is audio media, visual media, and audio visual media. We pick the first one, which is audio media. I did indicate early on that if this presentation currently ongoing is accessed through a wireless device or a radio device, then possibly you are only hearing voices or sound, but you are not seeing images and motion pictures. So when you listen to the local broadcaster in your locality through that wide megaphones that they mount, and they talk in the morning, they do the morning devotions, they sell a lot of other products, you are only having an audio appreciation of what they intend you to consume. So same way, if you are in a lecture and the lecturer uses a microphone and a hearing device or an amplified device, which can be a speaker, the microphone and the speaker put together produces audio, and so that would be an audio media. Then we have visual. Visual, Mr. Malcolm did indicate that when you have static images like maps, like images of former presidents that are displayed in a classroom settings, these ones are visual media. Then we have visuals that can also be in motion, that can be dynamic, but do not have sound. We have dynamic visuals that do not come with sound. So sometimes you have watched some videos which would be tagged non-sound or does not have sound. Then the third one is audio visual, which means a compilation of audio and visual. So it is the compilation of sound and dynamic images, which are not which run concurrent and produces harmony at the same time. So you don't have somebody moving the lips up and the sound running before the lip is opened. So this is also one opportunity we would come at when we classify instructional media. The next will be hardware and software, and Mr. Mwako would continue with that one.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dunford, for the classification. We have a question here from one of our students, Amon Israel from Counseling Psychology Department. He wants to find out the differences between instructional media and educational media. Instructional media and educational media. The first of all, we are saying that when we talk of educational media is the main concept. And by definition, we are saying educational media includes both human and material resources that are used in the teaching and learning. But when you talk of instructional media, that only talks about the material resources. So educational media are both human and material, because you need human to operate, you need human to make changes. But when we are talking of instructional media, then we are talking of only the material resources that are used in the teaching and learning. So you can still come in with your questions, 0503923158, 0503923158, or you can also call us on 0332320201, 0332320201, or you can also send us your message on Facebook and you'll be ready to read them out and answer them. So with the classification of instructional media, we are talking about all the types of media that we talked earlier on. How can we group these media into its major components? So Mr. Dankwa had made mention of, we have printed media, non-print media, and electronic media. So all the types, you can group them under these major headings. Then we have projected media and non-projected media. So all the types, you can group them. We've talked of audio media, visual media, and audiovisual media. Now we talk of hardware and software. With the hardware and software, will send us back to when we were discussing technology, and we talk of technology as a process and technology as a product. So we have the hardware component of it, and we have the software component of it, those that we cannot touch but aid us in the teaching and learning, and those that we can manipulate and we can touch it and feel it and also understand it. Then again, we have power consumption and non-power consumption. Some of the media need power, any source of power, whether direct electricity, whether battery, whether solar, or whether wind, to make it bigger or to make everybody hear. And some also don't use power. So the textbook, the pictures, the slides, the textbook, the pictures, the photograph, the map, the chart, they don't use power. But if you want to use slides, you need power to project. As my brother said, you need power to beam it for everybody to see. And the last one that we want to talk about, and we bring this lecture to a close, is the physical dimension. The media, the types of media that we talked about earlier, has its own physical dimension. When you talk of physical dimension, we are talking of how the model looks like. Is it a square? Is it round? How does it look like in terms of physics? How you can see it? You can also group them into those dimensions. So now it started with 1D. Now we have 2D, we have 3D, we have 4D, we have 5D. 16, and no. Even the latest one I know is the 6D version, which gives you all angles of that particular media or all angles of that particular object that you want to use to learn.
Yes. So, dear listener, we have at this stage been able to go through with you with the classification of instructional media, and as announced, we believe that you will be sending your questions, your contributions. But before that reaches us, we took you through print media, non-print media, and electronic media as the first classification of instructional media. The second classification was projected media and non-projected media, where we said that any media that is or that is beamed with light, or media that does not need light to be projected or used, such as print and what you can read on a substrate that has been definitely like printed on. Then the third one was audio media, visual media, and audiovisual media. Audio, all you can hear or make a listen to. Visual, either dynamic or non-dynamic, but without sound. Then audiovisual are visuals that come or is accompanied with sound. Hardware and software are the first, the interface for the software products that are used on your computer. The hardware are the gadgets that are used, say, example, the computer itself and other handheld devices that come in to support the instructional process. Then we have power consumption, which is devices that will need electricity or form of energy. And so you have your phone, which needs energy, you have your laptop, which needs energy, and you have the projector, the public address system. They all need electricity or energy to function. Then we have the physical dimensions that come as a way of measurements or sizes or dimensions. And so these are 1D, we call flat, 2D, 3D, up to 6D, all the heights, the breadth in which they come for or they come in. We have like this textbook I'm holding, it's an A5 sized or dimensioned test reading material. Others also would come in A4 or A6, depending on the purpose and the intention the instructor would want to have or has for the class. Mr. Marco, thank you.
So thank you very much, students. Today we've gone through the types of instructional media, eight characteristics, and eight classification. We are happy we came to your homes, to your hostel, to help you understand these concepts and to help me do the discussion was Mr. Dankwa Samuel, who is from Educational Foundation, and myself, Bernard Mesa Amwako, also from Educational Foundation. Thank you very much, and we say enjoy the rest of your day.
Live 90.3 FM and Great Four just gone by was Radio Lecture. That's for